Good afternoon and thank you. First of all, I want to thank the Pipers 597 for hosting this. This is a beautiful building, and we've done this here before, but they really put out for us, helped set this whole thing up, and made it happen. So a big thank you for the plumbers. Secondly, you guys have just drawn kind of a name out of the hat. We've got an order to go in, starting from 1 down to 4. Each of you will have 2 minutes for an opening statement to make. When you get down to 30 seconds, one of these lovely young ladies is going to hold up the 30-second card. When you get to 2 minutes, you'll be hearing a bell. At that point, you have nothing other to do than to finish your sentence, and please end after that. When questions are asked, I'll go in order. We'll start one, next one will be number two will go first, next one number three will go first, and so on down the road, so on down the line. As we do this, you'll have a minute and a half for each question. If you have a rebuttal to what someone says, please hold it to when you have your time as a question. I ask everyone sitting here, if you're putting out questions, and rather than saying, I've got a question for Mike or I've got a question for Richard, the questions that you're asking will be asked of all the candidates. We're not here to highlight one or another. We want to know basically the process that each one of them will go through. So as you're writing out your questions, think about that and say, listen, this is something that I want to have all the candidates talk about. I have a few questions that we at the Northeast Neighbors have put together that we're going to start out with. But please, as there's a card sitting at every table, please write down the question as you're going through. If you have another question that sparks from an answer that someone gives, write it down, raise your hand. Somebody will be walking around, they can grab that. We'll have it over here at the table so that we don't have any duplicate, and obviously so we don't have anyone with inappropriate questions. They'll be doing a little bit of screening over there. So with that, you guys have drawn your numbers, and coming up first is Mike. You have 2 minutes to introduce yourself.
Thank you. Schools, public safety, older neighborhoods, and the economy. My name is Mike Seville, and these are the issues why I'm running for mayor of Aurora. I was born and raised in Aurora, lived in the Sixth Ward all my life. I'm a third generation Aurora, fifth generation Illinoisan. I grew up in School District 129, went to McCleary, Jefferson, and graduated from West High. Went away to college, graduated from the Illinois, Chicago, University of Illinois, Chicago, and I majored in nationally political science, right? I came back to Aurora, and I was involved in trying to be active, and Jack Hill appointed me when he was mayor in 1980 to serve on the Planning Commission. In 1985, there was a vacancy on the council in the 6th Ward, and I was appointed to fill that vacancy by Mayor Dave Pierce. So I literally have decades of dedication serving you, the community. I've been involved in a lot of issues and policies. I've served on all the different committees of the City Council, BGI Committee, Building Grounds and Infrastructure, Government Operations Committee. I've served 18 years in the Finance Committee, going over the budget line by line, and I voted for 32 balanced budgets in 32 years. And I think that's significant because we need to watch your tax dollars to be frugal and fiscally conservative and yet be aggressive in terms of making policy. I've also served on the Planning and Development Committee since 1985, and I've been chair of that committee since 2003. I'm also chairman of the Aurora Riverwalk Commission. It was my idea in 1986 to form a riverwalk in downtown, and you can see the physical transformation of our downtown for the better. I think it's the best it's looked probably since the Fox Valley Mall opened it up in 1974. And actually, we now have 9 blocks of the Riverwalk built as well. So it was really a conjunction, two tandem idea, recreational opportunities, and economic development.
Thank you, Mike. Rick?
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I also want to thank Pipers 597, the Northeast Neighbors, the Pigeon Hill Neighbors, and all of you for coming out. At the past couple of forums, it's been suggested that leadership doesn't necessarily come from experience in government, or it doesn't come from 5+ years in the mayor's office, like what I've had. But what I would submit to you is I think that leadership, the true test of leadership should be being able to bring people together and deliver results. And so I think if you ask the developer of the St. Charles Hospital, which recently underwent a $20+ million historic renovation, and bring that building back to life, they'll tell you, here's a project that wouldn't have happened without my leadership. And Mayor Wisner, at the ribbon cutting a couple weeks ago, said as much. Yes, this is a project that needed city council support. It needed federal resources. It needed state resources. But it also needed somebody to bring all of the partners together, to cast the vision and to see the project through to completion. If you ask the developers of the new forthcoming Aurora Arts Center, that's going to convert the Waubonsie Community College building to a new restaurant, bringing jobs, and a new school for performing arts run by the Paramount Theater. They'll tell you, here's another project that wouldn't have happened without my leadership in putting that project together and seeing it through to completion. If you ask the more than 100 people who are now living in or growing up in a home that their family owns, because my wife and I started Emmanuel House, which helps hardworking families buy their first homes in Aurora, and was recently recognized as one of the 100 most innovative organizations of the year by the Stanford Social Innovation Review and the United Nations Foundation. And they said the leaders of these organizations that were recognized represent the brightest minds and the boldest leaders solving problems through innovation today. Collaboration, inclusivity, these are hallmarks of leadership that I will continue to bring in order to be able to move our city forward together.
Thank you. Linda.
Good afternoon. Thank you for everybody that came out today. I actually grew up in Pigeon Hill, the first ward, so thanks to the Pigeon Hill neighbors and the Northeast neighbors for putting this together and our Pipefitters. I want to get right down to the point on why I'm running for mayor of Aurora. I think we need a rock-solid commitment to transparency, accountability, and ethics in city government. We need to have an economic and development and jobs plan for the whole entire city, not just the downtown. And we need a sustainable budget. And I think when you see these three priorities, what we have as a result, we'll have more money to fight crimes and gangs on our streets right now. We're gonna have more resources for our children in the schools and the teachers so they can have a bright future like ours. And then we'll have jobs and we'll create more business here in Aurora. If we commit ourselves to these aspirations, not only the people in this room will see the effect, but also the people throughout the entire city of Aurora. My parents moved here more than 60 years ago, and they raised their children here. And I raised my children here, because I love Aurora. I graduated from the University of Illinois. I became a United States Commissioned Army Officer. Met a man of my dreams who's sitting over there. We opened up a few businesses. And I ran for office back in 2002 and won, and I've been representing you in the General Assembly since then, and a lot of people in this room. In fact, this is the district. Yeah, during my 14 years in the General Assembly, I've brought back millions of dollars for projects, including the one that Mr. Guzman's talking about, which could not have gone past the finish line, without my legislation in the 11th hour. I work very proudly and tightly with people on both sides of the aisle to get things done for Aurora. One takeaway from today's message, you don't have to remember anything else I said today, is that I love Aurora. I love its rich traditions, I love its community history, but we can do better. Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. Richard?
Good afternoon, everyone. You know, I was raised in Ward 1 as well, right on an Indian Trail. In low-income housing, and I've seen all of Aurora, both sides of the tracks, if you will, and really, what this next election is going to be about is which person up here has the vision to move Aurora forward. You know, not about individual projects, not about individual legislation. Who has the vision for the whole city to build Aurora? Who has the vision to address bringing businesses and jobs and opportunities back to the city? Who has the vision to make sure we have safety and nicely kept neighborhoods in our community that I know is important to you? Who has the vision to make sure that we focus on good education both on our east side and our west side, people moving out of a city based on the success of education? Who has the vision to make this city proud for all of us to call home? I have that vision. But it's not just about having the vision. It's about being the leader to get us there. You know, the leader that brings the business to the city by having strong economic development and creating new revenue. The leader that has the vision for working with community groups and walking in our communities with our seniors, making sure that we address the issues in our communities, walking with the police and inspectors to inspect our neighborhoods. I have the leadership that will support our school districts on both the east side and the west side by creating economic education commission. I have the leadership that we need to take Aurora to the next level, the successes we need to make Aurora proud to call home.
Thank you, Richard. Okay, we're gonna ask each candidate a question to get started here, although we've got some coming in here. This was something that both Northeast neighbors and Pigeon Hill wanted to ask. So we'll start with Rick. You're number one at this one. This is a fill in the blank question, and you will be limited to only one word answer, and you may not use the word lights. You cannot use lights. The question is, Aurora is the city of?
I would say Aurora is the city of togetherness.
Thank you. Linda?
It's easy for me. Possibilities.
Richard?
Opportunity.
And Mike?
Success.
Thank you. Okay, the next one we're going to start with Linda.
Number one word?
That's very good. So, by definition, a sanctuary city is a municipality that has adopted a policy of protecting undocumented immigrants by not prosecuting them for violating federal immigration laws. Are you in favor of officially making Aurora a sanctuary city at the risk of losing federal dollars?
So this is an interesting question. We tried to deal with this in Springfield last week and do a couple pieces of legislation, but the questions is very challenging for cities, but also for school districts, colleges, universities, and within those cities. It's more challenging by the president's immigration rhetoric and actions, which is creating a lot of anxiety among mixed status families. As a Latina, as a mother, as a wife, or someone who has been endorsed by labor unions and organizations that have first-generation membership, I can assure you that there's an anxiety or fear out there. But sanctuary cities, in my estimate, is not a legal destination designation. It's largely symbolic. And what we need to do is work with our law enforcement officers here to protect the citizens of the cities, just like the mayor has come out on this and the police chief. We should not be meddling in federal issues. So make it very clear that we need to protect our citizens that are here, but that is a federal issue, and we need to protect and make sure people feel home at home here.
Richard?
I think you asked a question that probably deserves a yes or no answer. You asked if, can you repeat that question?
Yeah, so by definition, a sanctuary city is a municipality that has adopted a policy of protecting undocumented immigrants by not prosecuting them for violating federal immigration laws. Are you in favor of officially making Aurora a sanctuary city at the risk of losing federal dollars?
No, I'm not. Let me tell you why. Only the federal government has jurisdiction over ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. Only the federal government. They have sole jurisdiction. For a city to attempt to legislate in that jurisdiction would be improper. Creating a sanctuary city would be an attempt to legislate in an area where we don't have jurisdiction, which would be the federal government. So the answer to my question is no. I would not be looking to make Aurora a sanctuary city.
Michael?
Yes, the idea of adopting the sanctuary city designation for Aurora, as was said earlier, it's really a symbolic gesture. It has no legal standing. The Immigration and Naturalization Service has the legal authority with regard to these issues, not the state, not the counties, not the municipalities. So I don't see the reason why the city would consider that. I would not propose it. And it would not have any legal standing. Ultimately, what's going to happen is due process, as we've seen occur after the recent executive order. The courts will decide there will be due process that will unfold. There will be court orders, and the federal government will be carrying out whatever it is that the courts decide is legal, but it has nothing to do with the city of Aurora.
Rick?
Yeah, I think this term has become a fairly inflammatory one, and it, again, is largely symbolic. It is an area of federal jurisdiction, and I think what's important for a mayor to understand, what's important for our city, is two things when it comes to the area of immigration. One is that immigration can be a tool that when people are committing crimes in our community, that can be used to be able to help make sure that that we can quickly deal with folks who are committing crimes. And so immigration and collaboration with our federal partners is something that is an important thing. Equally as important, if not more so, because this also affects our day-to-day safety, is that we need to continue to do the things that Mayor O'Connor, Mayor Wiseman before that, our chief, police chief, Kristen Zeman, have done, which is to reach out to the community to let folks know, and we've gotten, Chief Zeman has gone to numerous church services to let them know that if you are a victim of crime, if you are a witness to crime, we do not care what your immigration status is. We will not ask that, because if we do, we will not get the information that law enforcement needs to be able to fight crime in our communities. And if that becomes an issue, that will be an issue of advocacy that I will make sure that we continue to push, because it's very important to keep our communities safe.
Thanks, Rick. Okay, this one we'll start out with Richard, coming from the audience. We have many empty buildings on Galena and on the west side, Shopping Plaza. We have several buildings on Orchard Road. What is your plan to revitalize or reutilize, I should say, all these empty buildings?
All right. First, my plan is to create a plan for each ward, ward by ward. Ward 1 will have its own economic development plan. Ward 2, Ward 5, Ward 6. Every ward will have its own plan that we have to address. We create this plan by working with the aldermen, having them directly involved in the economic process in their ward. And then we involve the citizens, and they participate in helping us create this plan. Now, once we create a plan, it'll be simple to fill some of these empty buildings, because this plan will say that, you know, in the old Cub Foods building, we decide, you know, we want a Farm and Fleet. So our job, my job as the mayor, is to go out and lobby Farm and Fleet, market Aurora, and lobby and say, we want to bring you home to Aurora. What do we need to get you here? And we do this based on our plan. Let's say we want to fill the empty Hobby Lobby with some other store. And based on the plan that we've created, we go out and lobby. Businesses aren't going to come to Aurora and knock on our door and say, I want to come set up shop. It's our job, my job as the mayor, to actively seek out business, go to them, and bring them home to the city so they can participate in our economy.
Thanks, Richard. Mike?
Yes, I've worked closely with the economic development over the years, since 1985, and have literally approved billions and billions of dollars of development in our city since 1980. So I know what an economic development deal looks like, and have approved and adopted those. For example, when we first established the tax increment financing district in 1986, the end result is the Premium Outlet Mall close by here. That's the best TIF district in the state of Illinois, a 33,000% increase from what it was, and it helped solve the problems of flooding for Northeast neighbors. We have to think creative like that. We are talking with some vendors, or right now some retail vendors at West Plaza, but we need to concentrate on our economic corridors like Galena, Orchard, Hill, Farnsworth, Lake Street, East New York Street, and provide a business environment to induce businesses to come to Aurora, like the TIF districts, like sales tax rebates, like property tax rebates. Those are the kind of creative things that we need to do to think outside the box in order to get our economic development moving. I've been talking since day one that we need to embrace the smart economy, the so-called gigabyte city. We have fiber optic network over 67 miles, patterned ourselves after Santa Monica, Chattanooga, and Kansas City. That's why Aldi's recently came to Corporate Boulevard to hook up to our fiber optic network. We need to be ahead of the curve and embrace the future, and Aurora can do that.
Thank you.
Well, there are a number of, there are a number of things that I think that we do need to do, and this idea of creating targeted economic plans for our strategic corridors has been part of my platform since day one. I also want to create targeted business forums that actually talk to and regularly bring together the businesses that are in each of these strategic corridors to involve them in the solutions. When it comes to vacant buildings, I do want to point out that I do have some unique experience here. I mentioned the old St. Charles Hospital, a building that a lot of people thought was a goner, that wasn't going to be able to survive the recession. But we were able to do a $20 million plus renovation there, a more than $30 million renovation to three other historic buildings in the downtown, two of which were vacant, the old Carson's building, the old Stanley furniture building. These are buildings that were most recently Waubonsie Community College. They were off the tax rolls. They're coming back on the tax rolls now. The old Elks building, I was part of the team that put together a deal with David Karadimas to be able to get that building back on the tax rolls. The old library, a lot of us were worried that we weren't going to be able to find something to come in, but through business retention visits that Invest Aurora has been doing, we found a business in Aurora looking to grow, thinking about leaving Aurora. We're able to bring them down to the library, bring over 100 jobs there, and get a new tax-paying use in there. The former School District 129 building, over 300,000 square feet of vacant building space just in the last year alone, or this year moving forward, will be coming back onto the tax rolls because of projects that I've been involved in. And so I think we can do a lot more and continue that progress.
Thanks, Ray. Linda.
Thank you. There have been a number of excellent ideas that have been offered in the city already, and some good planning appears to have resulted. But the work has not led, and I feel has not led into a net gains for the city. Surrounding communities are thriving. New housing, commercial developments, speedy and efficient processes that encourage new business startups, safe and vibrant residential neighborhoods, quality public schools. You know, we can see some of the shining spotlights on the city, and we can take pride in that. But for every story that we hear that we've done here in the city, whether it's a library or River's Edge or the STEM school, there's so many unused properties that city and taxpayers are paying for right now. Empty storefronts, businesses still wondering in Aurora if we're going to be open for business, and a continued desire right now from the business community on an economic development and jobs plan that we can execute. Poor planning and poor execution are the major reasons our taxes are rising in Aurora. Since 2005, the only economic development plan the city has had is for the downtown. Earlier in my campaign, I rolled out an announcement, an economic development reform agenda that addresses how the city does business with business. And again, after listening to my opponents here, it's clear that those reforms must take place and we must move the city forward. There is reasons why I've been endorsed by the U.S. senators, township assessors, police associations, fire departments, city employees, building trades, and many of the community business leaders. It's because they feel that I'm the best prepared to take Aurora forward.
Thank you, Linda. Okay, we're gonna start with, goes back to Mike here. Question is, how will you work with Aurora Police Department to decrease crime and the gangs?
Well, I will continue to work with them as I have in the past, because I have the experience, leadership, and vision ideas to be able to come up with solutions that affect our city. And I'll give you a prime example. In 2008, City Council unanimously adopted what is called the Crime-Free Housing Ordinance. I co-sponsored that very ordinance. And what that did was it made landlords act responsibly and issued out consequences if they didn't. Since that time, you probably saw in the paper, not only have we had a 6.2% decrease in overall crime in 2016, but since that period of time, we had a 38% decrease in crime overall in the city of Aurora. That one ordinance alone is a prime example as to why crime has fallen, because it made landlords accountable, made them take a class on how to be a landlord, made them be registered, made them require criminal background checks for all renters, and made everything much safer for not only the renters, but for the surrounding neighborhood. So I will work with our chief. In fact, I've worked with our chief since she was a cadet in the community ordinance policing in 1991 when I had a problem in my ward. I work together with people to find common ground and to solve solutions and be aggressive for the people of Aurora, and I will continue to advocate for that. Working with the COP officers, we need to continue to civilianize the police department and get our police officers
Thanks, Mike.
Back on the street. Thank you.
Rick?
Well, Aurora's been telling an amazing story in terms of crime reduction. Mike mentioned some of the numbers. There's a lot more work to be done. That experience of crime going down has not been evenly felt by everybody, and so we can never let up. While Aurora has been recognized recently, and we've gone from being recognized as having some of the highest crime rates, highest murder rates, you know, 15, 20 years ago, to now being recognized recently as compared to the 150 largest big cities, Aurora was fifth safest overall. And that's a real testament to our police. And we have to recognize how we got here. And one of the things was a dedication to the philosophy of community-oriented policing. There's 300, roughly, sworn officers that we have. They're never going to be able to do the job alone. And so what they did is they got involved with community organizations, mentoring organizations, in the schools. And we need to continue that philosophy and spread it throughout the entire police force, not just the community-oriented policing unit. We need to increase the number of sworn officers who are on the street. We have a plan that has just started. We need to be as aggressive as possible to be able to civilianize those positions so that we can get more officers on the street. We need to be able to give homeowner groups resources to be able to get organized so that they can be partners with the police so that they can begin to build trust and relationships, because the police, as I said, they can't do it alone. They need all of our help to be able to make our city the biggest, the safest big city in the United States.
Thanks, Rick. Linda.
You know, crime is a big subject, and there's much to say, especially here in Aurora. First and foremost, we can and we must focus on specific causes of crime in Aurora so we can make neighborhoods safer and cut down on gangs and drugs. But at times, we cannot just think of crime in terms of homicide rates, especially in Aurora. And look that we've done a good thing from year to year as far as decreasing that. What we need to do and what we must do is focus on the not just one indicator of homicides, but the underlying causes to prevent several kinds of crimes. As your mayor, I will work with the community to understand the causes and the approaches that we're taking to address a broad range of crimes. Sexual assault, domestic violence, cyberbullying, theft and crime, crime against children, DUIs, gang violence. Crime manifests its ways in so many areas here in a city like ours. I have a strong record among law enforcement and educators across the state. I was recognized as a champion of children in 2013 by an organization made up of hundreds of law enforcement and crime survivors. I've served on task forces to deal with crime in the state. In September, I received an endorsement by the Police Benevolent Protection Association of the state. We have a dedicated and professional law enforcement community, and we need to work with them to give them the resources and the infrastructures they need to cut crime. Also, I'd like to thank our Pigeon Hill, because they came up with one of the first neighborhood walk programs that cut down the crime in their areas, so I applaud you.
Thank you, Linda. Richard.
You know, when I was Aurora's community-based prosecutor, I worked directly with the police to address crime in Aurora and to reduce it to the low levels that we see today by bringing in the Weed and Seed program, a federal program that we brought in through partnerships years and years ago. And what I learned working with the police and working with the community is that we're not going to arrest our way out of crime. You know, we had 30 murders in 1 year, 30 murders in a year, you know, 15 years ago, to the point where we had no murders in 2012, none at all. That didn't happen by simply making arrests. That happened by three things: community getting involved, returning to the beat cop police officers working on the street, and putting our youth in the youth programs and expanding our youth program. It's called problem-oriented policing. It's the big umbrella that encompasses everything. And once we focus on being proactive instead of reactive, we'll always keep crime in check. One example of what a thing we used to do when I worked with the community policing, community police as a community-based prosecutor, is I personally, boots on the ground, would walk in the community with our senior citizens around their neighborhood, and to be the police, our city inspectors and code inspectors, me as a community-based prosecutor, and we'd walk around just to make sure the community was safe and upkept. And we would do that consistently. I want to continue that. I want to expand that. So we make sure that you feel safe in your community, and we're making the whole city safe by working with the police and our citizen groups.
Thank you, Richard. Okay, we start with Rick is number one here. Next question. And I don't know how to qualify this, so I'm just going to ask it, assuming that whoever asked the question has read this and it is true. As reported in a variety of financial magazines, Aurora has the third highest tax rate in the country. How will you fix that, or what will you do to deal with it?
Well, first of all, that reporting that has happened is absolutely false. Completely, totally wrong. All right? So let's just get that out of the way first. There was a study that showed, that looked at 51 cities out of almost 20,000 in the country, that looked at one city per state. And they looked at two cities in New York and Illinois, because Chicago, they looked at the largest cities, Chicago and New York tax very differently than the rest of the state, so they looked at the second largest cities. And so what this was as an indicator of what of our state. And our state, we all know, is in shambles. Our state has a junk bond bond rating, our junk status bond rating. Our state is $150 billion in debt, $12,000 for every man, woman, and child. We've been rated the least business friendly. So we have a victim of being in the state of Illinois, and there are hundreds of other communities in Illinois with higher tax rates than Aurora, depending on where you live. And so we'll clear that air up first. Sorry, I get a little bit defensive when I hear those things.
I understand.
Those things bantered around, because they're wrong, and we need to get our facts straight. What we need to do is we need to be able to move more towards efficiencies, consolidation, mergers, joint ventures, opportunities to be working more collaboratively with all of the other levels of government, so that we can continue to be as responsible as we have been in Aurora.
Thanks, Rick. Linda.
I don't know. Anybody want to raise your hand if you feel like you're paying too much in taxes? Really? Come on. We are. And you know, you can say the state of Illinois, Rick, but your project wouldn't have been done over at St. Charles Hospital without my help in the state of Illinois and the dollars that we brought into that. So it's very easy to throw people under the bus, right? But my opponents don't appear to have a bold vision. Instead, they want to blame Springfield. And for all the city's problems, for all the problems, well, they're either misinformed or they're being disingenuous. The idea is that Aurora is never focused on economic development plan. And I was talking to some folks earlier about this. If you look at Rosemont, which I know the mayor that runs that city, they give a tax rebate to their citizens. Close to $1,000 was given back to one girl I know. And why? Because they thrive in economic development and they're pro-Aurora. Everyone in this room, from head to toe to inside your tummy to your gas tank, should be buying pro-Aurora. You know why? Because those taxes then go into the city of Aurora coffers, eventually back from the state. And what we need is somebody who already has a relationship on both sides of the aisle to bring more money back here and have a bold vision for the entire city, not just the downtown. I've also been discussing how do we work with our business climate, especially with the 125 people I have and businesses at the table coming up with a program on how we help them thrive. Because if we can help a rural business thrive, then your taxes will go down in filling those empty buildings.
Thank you. Richard?
You know, I can't say how right or wrong that article that talked about Aurora having the highest tax rate, one of the highest tax rates in the state, but I can say our taxes are absolutely too high here in Aurora. And, you know, we can make excuses about why it is or why this person is right or this person is wrong, and we can pretend like we're not in the state of Illinois, and the state of Illinois doesn't participate in why our taxes are so high. We can make excuses, but the reality is we've got to do something. We've got to execute if we want to make a difference. Execute, and that's what a leader does. What I want to do is I want to focus on the economic development to bring what's called critical mass to Aurora. The more rooftops, the more people we have in Aurora participating in our tax base, the more our tax will stabilize or go down. I want to create what's called a taxing body consortium. That means when you get your bill and you see some's coming from the school district, some coming from the park district, some coming, you don't care. All you know is that your taxes are too high. So the only way we're going to be able to address that is to work with all the taxing bodies working together to make sure we're not duplicating services and to make sure now we're not overtaxing you from taxing body to taxing body to taxing body. The only way that's going to happen is if we communicate with each other. Right now, we do not. We've got to have a better education. People moving out of the city based on the success of education. Without education on our east side and our west side being improved, we're not going to get those folks moving into the city. You know, we've got to focus on making sure we keep crime in check.
Thank you. Mike?
Yes. We've been trying to lower the tax levy since 2005. We've been very successful in attempting to do that and succeeding over the years. Right now, and everything that Rick Guzman said about the article is factual. It's very true. I read the same article. It was a very misleading article since day one. So I would say that, and I've been advocating for this, that we need immediate school funding reform in the state of Illinois. Our state is 47th out of 50 states. We're only three states from the bottom. The state of Michigan changed their school funding formula just a few short years ago. With one bill in their General Assembly, they made their regressive property tax funding of their schools much more fair. We need to do that as well. So what I've been promising, once I'm your mayor, my administration will call every mayor, municipality in the state of Illinois, will call every school board president, will call every school superintendent to form a coalition to advocate for this. Pension reform. This year, for 2017, the city of Aurora, we had to find an extra $2.1 million to fund pensions for our city employees. Next year, we have to find the same amount. Next year after that, the same. And if you look up to 2040, we have to find an extra $71 million of your money to fund pension reform. That's unconscionable, has to change. And I'll work to do that.
Thank you, Mike. All right, this starts out with Linda. And this is something that we've seen, this kind of in a broad sense across the country. Everyone that has run for office talks about, you know, the unemployment number, and that, you know, across the country the unemployment number is 4.7%. I guess I'd argue that there's a lot of people that are, if not going to unemployment or underemployed, that aren't in those numbers. So taking along, I guess, the economic development side of this, what are your plans for getting well-paid jobs back into Aurora?
Goes back to my business community roundtable that I have and what I have on my website. If you'd like to go to it, it's chapolivia.com. But also working with, and I was able to bring in the Women's Business Development Center here in Aurora, and that was federal dollars, that I had a lot of help from different women that had businesses here in Aurora and how to get them here and help transform women that had an idea to go into business, but then to get the education, the training, the certification, and then actually get in microloans. So it's very important for me, economic development and jobs portion of me running for office is the biggest thing we have. If we have business in here, we can bring better jobs and more people want to work here and stay here and live here and continue their life here. So part of my issue, my platform, not only with my business economic development jobs plan, but is also that I already have relationships built with state entities and federal entities on how to get the federal dollars here. There are a couple questions also on the table of having a transportation center. With our new president now, he's going to be focusing on a lot of infrastructure and bridges throughout this country. We should be able to get some of those dollars coming in here as well. If you go to my website, you'll see more of my platform there.
Thank you, Linda. Richard.
Jobs, jobs, jobs. That has to be our mantra. Jobs, jobs, jobs. But how do we get jobs in the city? Well, first we have to sell and market ourselves. We focus on this river that runs through our city, beautiful river. It's a diamond in the rough. We focus on the fact that we are a transportation hub that stops and starts right here in Aurora. And what I haven't talked about, we have an airport. Aurora, city of Aurora, has a municipal airport. Not many cities can boast that. We've got to market this. Once we market, that we're a full access city, that we have transportation coming in and out of our city, we'll be able to attract the jobs. I meet with a small business group right now, that business owners in the city of Aurora, I've been meeting with them for the last year. One of them owns a number of our hotels here in the city of Aurora, the one downtown, the Holiday Inn Express, and over on Orchard. He says, Richard, the minute you become mayor of Aurora, I want to build a full service hotel with a conference center right here in Aurora, because I know that you have skin in the game and I want to invest in Aurora and put more of my skin in the game because I believe in your leadership. I have another gentleman that owns a restaurant both on the west side of Spartan House and on the east side, O'Malley's. It says, Richard, I'll build an Italian restaurant the minute you become mayor because I believe in your vision and I'm willing to put more skin in the game because I know you've got skin in the game. Jobs, jobs, jobs. We bring in economic development, we bring in new tech companies, we bring in light manufacturing and focus on some of our manufacturing areas that that are untapped and unused on the east side, and we can bring this economic development that we're looking for.
Thank you. Mike.
If you go to my website, MikeSevilleForMayor.com, I have my catchy title right, and you can see my plan. It's a very complex plan about our future. We'll never see the businesses that we used to see in Aurora, which Boston Western, Richard Wilcox, Thor Power, or Lion Metal. Those old manufacturing jobs are gone for good. But what we'll, and what we can see is the future, and that is the smart economy. As I was saying earlier, we've laid over 67 miles of fiber optic network. We need to capture that. Like I was mentioning earlier, Aldi's came to Aurora because they want the download capacity of 100 gigabytes per second, with the idea of increasing that, to doubling that, once they get up and running. That is our future. That is something that we need to embrace. And there's a way we can pattern ourselves after those three cities I mentioned earlier, because they're already doing it. They're offering programs for people and policies and incentives to get these young people in town who are building these new businesses or building these apps and having good paying, living wage jobs. All we have to do is follow their lead and offer that to businesses, because that is the future. Businesses all over the country are waiting for the capacity to download that type of capacity of gigabytes in order to increase and expand their businesses. That will mean a lot. And I propose to focus that fiber network along our downtown as well.
Thanks, Mike.
Rick? Well, as is the case with most of these things, there are no 90-second answers to a lot of these things. There are a lot of things we need to do in economic development. I've got a website, a long list of plans as well, guzmanforaurora.org. But I think the question was actually about employment rates and underemployment. And so what I want to talk about is my work, not just when the Pathways to Prosperity initiative started in Aurora, but every single month, meeting with our educational institutions, our four of our school districts are the ones that have the most population in Aurora, also with our many of our business communities and with our institutions of higher education, Waubonsie Community College and Aurora University, and to work together to not only identify where the jobs are, and we have identified that. We know that there are jobs going unfilled in our community and around our community in the areas of advanced manufacturing, information technology, and health sciences. And so we've begun training kids, getting dual credit certifications while they're in high school still. And we have a new technical training center that's being built on the west side in the next year that's going to give an opportunity not only for students to be able to get those skills while in high school, but it's also going to be an opportunity to be able to partner again with those institutions of higher education and to have a training center that we can then also be talking to employers about, saying, look, we're developing a pipeline, a talent pipeline that you could be, that if you bring your business here, we're going to have that skilled workforce that you need, and we can take those underemployed folks and they can use that facility after hours.
Thanks, Rick. This would start with Richard. There certainly is a, I guess you'd call it, a diverse economy of scale from the residents that live here, from low-end housing to probably the top 1% of the country to fall into that. Do you believe, because City of Aurora is kind of like a little country here, do you believe that Aurora should be restructured into zones so that they can better focus on the different desires and needs of the residents that live here. Do you believe that Aurora should be restructured into zones so that they can better focus on the different desires and needs of the people who live here?
Is that the best of our question?
I don't know. Yes.
The question is, due to the size of Aurora geographically, should we take our best of Aurora and separate it to the west side, the near east and west, and east side, so they can better provide the desires and needs of those particular geographic areas?
Let me repeat the question. Do I think that based on the fact that we have different geographic areas in the city of Aurora, should Invest Aurora focus on addressing each geographic area and its need? That's not a bad idea, actually. All right, so let's talk about the east side of Aurora. The east side of Aurora, which, you know, the first ward falls in, you know, we've got pushing up on 90% poverty on the east side of Aurora. You know, our school district is only graduating about 45% of the population that goes to high school. So of course, 45% are not graduating from high school. So what we have to do is address that particular area first, meaning we have to focus on the corridors on the east side of Aurora, which would be the Kirk Road corridor or Farnsworth corridor going south. We've got to focus on the Hill Avenue corridor. We've got to focus on every corridor and every area where we can do economic development on our east side. Now, you know, we'll do the same thing on the west side. We'll do the same thing on the far east side. But we do have to address our areas based on their need. Because, you know, if we take a global approach to addressing Aurora, we're going to tend to leave out those areas that are in most need. So, you know, once we focus on our gateways into Aurora, which come into our low-income areas on Kirk and Hill, then, you know, and start addressing on building those areas up, you know, I think we can start making a change in the east side, which will affect the whole of Aurora.
Mike, you're up.
Yes, I think that's a good idea as well. We have an economic development arm in the city, a corporation called Invest Aurora, and we have an executive director who reports to the board of directors, and we have a lot of staff. So I think that would be a good idea to focus on all the economic corridors that we have, and also divide the city into three zones, west side, near east, and far east side, in order to have some accountability with the staff that works under this Invest Aurora corporation. And I think it would be better in terms of having personal responsibility as well as working with the mayor and city council as to exactly what our focus is, what type of jobs and businesses that we want to see in those zones, and make sure that we address our needs, especially in the East Side School District. That East Side School District is landlocked, as we all know. District 131 is our most in need school district, so to speak, because of the decisions that have been made previously, going back to not expanding the school district in the early 1970s when they had an opportunity, and the 1957 upzoning, which added more people in terms of the ability to take out permits and reconvert homes from what was single family up to multifamily homes. So it's really a multi-prime approach that I would support, doing other things as well, establishing an uplifting our older neighborhoods. They can't pass this on.
Rick? No, I think it's a great idea. I think that, and here's a couple of reasons why. First of all, I think that, and we've all talked about whether it's targeting certain strategic corridors, whether it's talking about individual plans within wards. I think that we do need to have some focused efforts in certain areas, and one of the reasons. Well, and we're here and talking about the East Side School District here a little bit, this specific area. I believe in the tenets of asset-based community development. ABCD. Sorry, I almost got that wrong. ABCD. And that is, and the reason I believe in that is because I think oftentimes we look at certain areas and we don't recognize the tremendous assets that are there. The East Aurora School District is not 90% poverty. It's been coming down, and it is not poverty. It is it's actually low income. And the low income is 185% of poverty. What we have is we don't have a disproportionate amount of poverty citywide. We have a disproportionate amount of hardworking people who just happen to be earning low wages. But hard work, ethic, those things are assets. And if we can put them to use, that's what Emmanuel House did. Is we said, look at all these people who are earning a good, who are earning income, who are making it month to month, and now we're helping them build wealth. So what we need to do is we need to stop looking at these deficits. And I think if we do what you're suggesting, and we look at these areas, we'll start to see more of the assets that are there within it that we can build on. So I think that's a great idea.
Thank you. Linda?
Absolutely. In fact, I don't know if Invest in Aurora is the vehicle. We don't have a business department in the city of Aurora. And when my husband and I moved back here and started our businesses in downtown Aurora, it took us a year and a half to open up our business. So we need to be inviting them and welcoming for business, period. But we also need to develop every neighborhood within the city. We need to talk to not only our ward aldermen, but the people that sit within their wards to find out what they want and have them part of the process. Right now, there is a breakdown in process on what you need in your wards. So it's almost like we have three different cities. We have downtown central Aurora, we have far west side, far east side. If far west side, they'd rather get on 88 and go around the town to go to the outlet malls. They'd either rather go to Yorkville. We're not supplying them what they need. People want to be able to go to walk to where they need to shop. They want to have places they can go dine. They want to make sure that we have a city that's inviting and welcoming to business. And they want an economic development plan that's going to be executable. So those three areas, of course, I would work on with every alderman to make sure we're giving your ward what it needs, because they all are different. But we need to give them that ability to spend their tax dollars here in the city so we can lower your property tax and other things that the city works with you or works for you on. So absolutely.
Thanks, Linda. Let's take that to the next level of, as you just finished up. We're gonna start with Mike on this one. Aurora is successfully drawing crowds to events at Paramount and at the River's Edge. But what is there for them to do either before or after events? Where do they eat? Where do they park? Where do they socialize? Do they come in, go to this, and leave? How do we keep them here? How do they spend money here?
That's always been the challenge, hasn't it? Going back to the Hollywood Casino when that opened up in 1992, is how do we capture the people that are coming to our downtown and our city? And we literally have millions of people coming every year to our downtown. From, as mentioned, not only the Paramount, we have over 300,000 people a year subscription level. We are the third highest subscription level Paramount in the United States. We have over 100,000 people a year coming down to the River Edge Park, and we have millions of people coming to their casino every year. So how do you capture that? Well, we've been attempting to do that with the Restaurant Row on East New York Street, and the new restaurants that recently opened at the Leland, the Legends, the one that's being planned for the Mayan building, which is the former Elks building. And we've been offering incentives every step of the way with regard to the tax financing district in the downtown, sales tax rebate, property tax rebate. But ultimately, what you need to do is you need population. You need a higher demographic population. And we tried to do that with the Sodine property that was approved in 2005 on the southeast bank of the downtown. And that would have built over 900 housing units, 250,000 square feet of retail space. And if it wasn't for the Great Recession, you would have seen that occur. And in that plan was another section of my Riverwalk that was going to be built between Benton and North Avenue.
Thank you. Rick?
Well, we need to continue to drive demand for more restaurants, and we need to be able to continue the kinds of things that the Paramount has started. 6 years ago, when the new leadership took over, they were selling about 50,000 tickets a year. Last year, 350,000 tickets a year. I mentioned the new Aurora Arts Center that's going to bring a projected 150,000 to 200,000 visitors on top of that per year. And so we'll go from 50,000 to 500,000. That'll help. That's one of the building blocks. That's one part. That's one piece. Mike had mentioned needing to be able to increase the number of housing units downtown, and that part of my platform has been to double the number of housing units. We've got about 650 to 70 that are downtown. We have essentially a zero vacancy rate, and so there are opportunities to be able to grow. There are opportunities to be able to talk to developers and tell them the story of Aurora being revitalized, this, you know, sell what we have that Aurora, a lot of our surrounding communities don't have, not only our natural beauty with the river and the trails that run up and down, but this edgy arts scene, cultural and ethnic diversity. we can, if we're working more together with all of the different, the Convention and Visitors Bureau, the Chamber of Commerce, Invest Aurora, all of these entities, we can sell Aurora. We can do what we did out at the Route 59 train station, which is over the last 10 years, we've built 1,400, partnering with developers, 1,400 new units of transportation-oriented development. We can do the same thing in downtown Aurora at our other train station.
Thank you. Linda.
Can you repeat the question?
Certainly. Aurora is successfully drawing crowds to events at the Paramount and River's Edge, but what is there for them to do before and after events? Where do they eat? Where do they park? Where do they socialize? How do we get people to stay and stay downtown and spend money downtown?
Thank you. And I just want to thank you all because you put money into the River's Edge. That was one of my first pieces of legislation I was able to do with Mayor Weiser at the time. And it brought us all the dollars to make it affordable for developers to come down and build on the brownfields that we have downtown. So thank you very much. Millions of dollars came back to create that. Part of my platform is working with other entities outside of Aurora. We need to go find people to come move here. We can't just wait here and let them come to us. It's not going to happen. I've been talking with the Metra and the Pace people on how we can get advertisement on their trains and busing so we can bring people here. We already have a beautiful train station that brings people all the time in from Chicago and brings them down. But working with entities like SciTech and seeing if we can rebuild some children's a museum that's right there on the riverfront or across the river and attracting businesses to come down here so people will have a reason to stay. But we need to utilize the rail more. We can advertise up and down the rail so people know what we have going on, whether it's the Paramount, whether it's the River's Edge, whether it's SciTech, whether it's our beautiful new library that it was part of your dollars that came back to. It's important that we start communicating and marketing Aurora outside of Aurora, not waiting for people to come, but go get them and bring their business here and keep them here with their ideas.
Thank you, Linda. Richard.
When the Hollywood Casino first came in, we were promised that there was going to be a lot of foot traffic downtown and fill up our downtown. It didn't happen. When Wilmington Community College was built downtown, we were promised there's going to be so much foot traffic with all the students and all the teachers going on. It didn't happen. Now with the Paramount and the park, they're saying, oh, we just create this art environment and oh, all these people are going to come. There's going to be so much traffic downtown. It's not happening. So then the question becomes for Aurora, what becomes first, the chicken or the egg? The people or the more businesses? Well, in Aurora, we know it's the people that are going to have to come first. The more folks, the reason people don't stay around downtown is because they don't live down there. They don't feel safe down there. We've got to create safety and we've got to have people living downtown. Then people will stay because after they're done at the Paramount, they'll walk two blocks home. Then they'll eat at restaurants along the way. After people finish at the Riverboat or finish up their night at Wabonsie Community College, they walk a couple blocks and they go home. The more folks we've got downtown, the more business we'll have downtown because now we have all these heads or rooftops. We have restaurants that want to cater to them. We have grocery stores that want to cater to them. We have shops that want to cater to them. The more people we get there, the way we do that is we market our city, we market our river, we market our transportation center, just like we did out on 59, and we market the heck out of Aurora. All those folks that are going to be leaving Chicago because the taxes are too high there, they're going to need somewhere to come. We bring them here right downtown Aurora. We start to grow our downtown, we'll grow the rest of the city.
Thank you, Richard. Okay, we're going to start with Rick with the next question. If you are elected mayor, which city department would you reorganize to better respond to citizens' needs in a timely manner?
It's a good question. And there's actually a decent amount of reorganization, I think, that is healthy. And one of the areas, I think, is in the area of economic development. I think that right now, part of it is, you know, we're a little bit physically disjointed. So we've got our planning department that's separated from our buildings department, separated from our engineering department in different areas, and again, separated once again from Invest Aurora. I think that we do need to be extremely intentional about, and this is, and I don't think anyone up here is going to disagree, economic development is going to be one of the, if not, is the most important thing for our city to be able to be working together. And when I look at, we talk about the tremendous progress we've made in crime. The way that we did that was being community-oriented, by being inclusive and involving everybody in that. We need to do the same thing with economic development, and there's some culture shift that needs to happen. We need to get every single city staff person, our partners at Invest Aurora and the Chamber of Commerce on board with the idea that our job is to help economic development happen, to get it to completion. So what we need to do is we need to reorganize in a way that every single staffer, from the frontline inspector all the way up to those who are running these departments, understand that their job is not to stand in the way of economic development, but their job is to make sure that it happens and that we are facilitating private industry and not trying to enforce our own rules.
Thanks, Rick. Linda?
Well, I'll just go based off of my relationship with the city when we first moved here and opened up our businesses and how long it took us to open our business. The permits department. And we need to get more business-minded, focused business people within the city running those departments so they can see so they can train the employees how long it takes to open business. If we delay business, we delay in getting tax dollars and making their lives better off and lowering your property tax. It all comes back to property tax and what we take from you. I want to make sure that we are open and welcoming for business. So the permit department, looking at the idea of producing a business department so we know who's paying taxes and who's not in the city. And let me tell you, there are people that are not paying taxes in the city, just like those properties that are vacant that you're paying taxes for, the city's paying taxes for. One of the two, it's kind of the same. So it's very important, the business department, the permits department, making sure that we're working with business folk that have gone through the gauntlet here to try to open their businesses, and then some of them just leave. People don't ever want to be in Aurora to put the business here because what they have to go through. So that's going to be my biggest focus. We are going to surround them with a team of five people, 24/7, making them know we want them here. We're going to open them as soon as possible so we can look at a great new Orchard Road in Farnsworth bustling with business. Heck, we don't even have a movie theater here, you guys. We really need a lot. We really need a lot.
Thank you. Richard?
No, I think the inspections department. We've got, on the east side of Aurora, let's just talk about the east side. You know, we've got overcrowding. We've got overparking. We've got, the overcrowding puts a drain on our school district and the resources. If we say we want to attract people to the city of Aurora, we've got to make it inviting. We've got this city that has so much beautiful architecture, that has so much to offer. You know, we're allowing it to be run down with overcrowding, overparking. You know, in our inspection department doesn't have the tools and the manpower to consistently keep this in check. You know, as I said, when I was a prosecutor, I walked with the police and inspectors. So we walked around the neighborhoods inspecting properties. You know, I think it's important for us to continue to do that. You know, and we see that right now in Aurora, do you know that we have an ordinance that says you can have 8 cars parked in your driveway? A home can have 8 cars. That's unacceptable. We've got to cut that more than in half, because that's overcrowding and overparking. We've got to reduce that. You know, right now in Aurora, you know, if you go to some areas on the Near East Side, you can't find a place to park. There's cars back to back to back to back, and we know that that's the case because there's got to be overcrowding somewhere. Where are all these cars coming from? So until we give our inspection department the tools to beautify our city, you know, when people come and look and consider about relocating here, they won't see what we see.
Thank you, Richard. Mike?
As I mentioned earlier, I'm pro-business and business-friendly, and I have the facts to prove that because I've voted billions upon billions of dollars of economic development in our city. But I would choose economic development office as well to make sure that we're all on the same page. To make sure that what we're doing is not only making businesses thrive in business districts and in our economic corridors, but our neighborhoods thrive as well, because ultimately we're a community of neighbors. And if the neighborhoods thrive, then the school districts will as well. But what I want to make sure as well as mayor is that we are very business friendly, that we have a ad hoc committee called the DST, Design Services Team, made up of representatives of city staff, planning, zoning, economic development, inspections, fire, police, streets, engineering, And I want to make sure that once a potential developer comes and meets with that committee, that they go away from that committee, that they're both on the same page. Because invariably I've heard over the years that there are misunderstandings and the developer walks away and he thought one thing was said, in reality, it was just the opposite. So I want to make sure when the developer makes his investment, and sometimes, as we know, it's millions and millions of dollars in our community, that they don't do it by mistake. I think that's unconscionable. And I will do all I can to make sure we promote businesses, because ultimately, we want to be able to expand the tax base and cut taxes.
Thanks, Mike. I should have mentioned this at the beginning, but we're going to end somewhere around 3:30. You're certainly willing to, or can certainly hang around and ask questions of all the candidates. And we'll be here until at least 4 o'clock. So, but with that, let's continue. This one starts with Linda. Certainly, schools and school districts are always a question, and funding them adequately is obviously a problem or an issue. What game plan or methods do you have to either keep up or help extra or help funding the support of the schools?
So the funding formula that you hear my colleagues talking about, it's House Bill 2808. It's actually one of the bills that I sponsor. So that's first and foremost. But there are no new funding revenue in it, so it's just like changing chairs in a room. I have been involved in education for 14 years in the General Assembly, whether the policy or the billions of dollars for over 800 school districts. It's not an easy 90-second message, okay? So if anybody would like to talk to me more about this, I will have time. I will stay here with you and give you an education on it. The majority of property tax goes to school education. And I know you've looked at your bills, and I want to say 67% of the tax bill on one side of the town and 66 or 65 on the other. So I'll talk to you that if you'd like to. But as a mayor, based on my experiences working with Mayor Weisner on either the Aurora STEM school that we were able to put in there, and four school districts are benefiting from that, and bringing that legislation to fruition, but also getting money for that. But what we can focus on here in Aurora as a mayor is to help to make sure that we do early education. I've been working with not only Spark, but also the Women's Business Development Center, help other women and men get into early childhood academies so we can help support them with the $70,000 microloan, but also working within communities and marketing them, just like East Aurora. East Aurora is an amazing school district.
Thank you. Richard.
The state of Illinois is almost last in the nation, in the United States of America, for providing school funding for its education. Now, I'm not blaming the state. It is what it is. It's the reality. But we got to blame somebody, you know, or we got to recognize that we're not going to get any help from the state. The fact that they can't balance a budget right now is affecting our school district's ability to function. So recognizing that the state is broken and we can't get any support from it, there's two questions we got to ask, because the question should always be, how is what we do going to affect our school district? Let's talk about the east side, because that's where we're at. And that's where I graduated from. There's two ways. Either we raise taxes, and no one wants to raise taxes. I don't want my taxes raised any higher. Or we've got to bring in economic development. Once we bring in those economic development streams, you know, we'll be able to support our school districts more. But it can't stop there. We've got to focus on making sure our school districts are successfully turning out, you know, graduates and people that are prepared for the workforce, for these jobs we're going to attract here. We do that by these businesses that we have in the city, partnershipping them with the schools so they can support our schools to provide co-ops and externships and apprenticeships. So if our kids are dropping out of school at high rates because they've got to stay home, they're poor and they got to stay home and help the family, well, guess what? They still get paid, but they get paid to stay in school, so they got money to help their family stay in school, and when they graduate, they've got a career to participate in. So, and this also affects reducing crime. The more participation, the more we can help our school district.
Thank you, Richard. Michael. Mike.
Yes, funding of our school districts, as we've been talking about this afternoon, is our number one priority. And the school funding formula in the state does have to change. Other states have done it. I think we can as well. Ultimately, and I'm going to propose something that I haven't talked about tonight, I'm going to propose that we have a meeting of the community, especially with regard to School District 131 to talk about how we can uplift economically that school district, because that school district is our weakest link. Because of it being landlocked, because of the decisions that were made in the past, that is our greatest challenge for our community. Now, how do you do that? Well, you do it with some aggressive rezoning, making sure we can attract businesses, maybe creating another tax increment financing district on Hill Avenue. In my day, that was an economic corridor, right? There was a lot of businesses up and down there. We don't see that so much anymore. We have to open that up again and make it very business friendly for people to locate, even expand our fiber optic down that street. We also have to look at our neighborhoods. I represent an older part of our city. In 1991, in fact, I was talking about reconversion and reducing the density since I was on the Planning Commission. In 1991, 1992, we created the first density reduction program, giving people incentives to convert their homes back to single family, providing owner occupancy status for people that want to achieve the American dream.
Thanks, Mike. Rick?
We've talked a lot about the problems and not being able to rely on Springfield because they've been unable to be able to deliver what we need for our schools. And so I think what we need to begin to think about is obviously what we can do. And I think growing the tax base is one of the things that would be the top priority of any of us. We know that that's something that we can control. But there's also something else that has been very successful in being able to bring additional resources, and that is, you're going to hear this from me again and again, collaboration. So we have a collaboration. I talked about Pathways to Prosperity, but I also have been involved every month in our Early Childhood Initiative, Strong, Prepared, and Ready for Kindergarten, SPARK. I've been there consistently working to be able to bring additional resources to improve the quality of early childhood. New resources that we just got because we're collaborating together across school districts with the city, with the Dunham Fund, with a variety of partners to be able to have more home visiting for 0 to 3 year olds. A grant that we got $11 million that we would not have gotten if we were not collaborating together to bring 400 new preschool slots to both the east and west sides. And so what we need to do is, instead of having these individual efforts, what we need to do is we need to create a cradles to career spectrum that works with our early childhood all the way through higher education.
Thank you very much. Okay, so the next question starts with Richard. We talked about economic development, obviously bringing businesses into the Aurora area. But in this question, give your definition of a gateway street in Aurora, the gateway streets you believe are in Aurora, and how you'd work with residents and the businesses that are already there to improve what they're doing.
You know, that's actually the largest part of my economic development plan. Redevelopment and expanding the businesses that we already have here. And let me talk about the gateways first. So I talked about Hill Avenue and building that gateway corridor up because it's a gateway into the city of Aurora. I talked about Farnsworth, not just Farnsworth North over the bridge, but Farnsworth South, which will feed into the District 131 school district. The way we work with the businesses there is to, first, we don't have a mechanism to identify all the businesses in the city of Aurora. We don't know all the businesses that sit in our city. Through my Economic Development Commission that I want to recreate, our first goal is to identify all our businesses, work with them to identify what their issues may be, how the city can help, and how we can help them grow. Because that just doesn't help that business, it helps the whole city. Because now if they're growing, they've got more job opportunities, they've got people that they need to hire. So it grows. We know that small business is the backbone of the United States of America. That's no different here in Aurora. So we've got to make sure we support our small businesses and give them what they need to be successful. And that holds true on Farnsworth, going south, on Hill Avenue, coming into the city, and throughout the east side of Aurora. We've got to focus on building up what we have here at home. Doesn't make sense to attract five new businesses here in the city, only lose six. We've got to take care of our businesses here at home.
Thanks, Richard. Mike?
It's very important that we not only attract new business, but we can retain businesses that we have and allow them an opportunity to grow and prosper. That is key, because we don't need them moving out of our city when we're trying to attract new business to do it. So what we can do is look at the instruments that we have to help them, and making sure that they, number one, we can partner with them, and number two, meet their needs. We've recently did that in my ward, the Save-A-Lot grocery store. They came into my ward a couple of years ago, and they had a need, and they worked with the Invest Aurora Economic Development Office, and we gave them incentive to put in new flooring, to upgrade their flooring that they desperately needed, because it was the old flooring of what it was the Walgreens. But these are the small things that can make a difference, that can make a business thrive or close down. So I think Invest Aurora needs to make sure that, again, we have communication between the city and between our business community, making sure all the tools are there, that we can partner. And because absolutely that this is important, because this is their livelihood, and this means jobs for our community. People live in our community and work there, and it means so much for everybody. So that'll be key. There are a lot of incentives, like I talked earlier, the TIF district, tax rebates, property tax rebates, sales tax rebates. I would continue that as well. The economic corridors that I mentioned too, we need to make sure that they're stable and growing.
Thanks, Mike. Rick?
Our gateways are really important because they are oftentimes the first impression that people see. And so when you think about New York Street, that's an important gateway, really important gateway that we need to continue to do some work on. And we have had some new investment happening there, but we've got to continue that work. You think about, obviously, Galena on the west side and the challenges that we've had out on in West Plaza. I think in some cases we need to actually develop entire new master plans. We may need to reimagine, redefine some of these areas. Future of the West Galena Corridor may not be big box retail. We've got opportunities to be able to working with regional experts, as we have done, to be able to bring in the types of expertise, but also stories of other communities where this is happening too. Some of these stories are not unique stories, but the way to do it, once again, is going to be a collaborative effort, a way of including people. When I started my campaign, I did so, and I had a white paper out there, but I didn't release my platform because I wanted to go on a listening tour first and actually hear from people. What did they want to see? And include their ideas. One of the things that ended up in my platform is the idea of geographically targeted business forums. This is regularly bringing business owners together, making sure they understand all of the tools. The Finish Line grant, which is only in the downtown, but we need to be able to figure out ways to continue to expand things like that. Partnerships with the SBA-funded programs, community development block grant programs. There are a lot of things that we can be bringing to these forums so that they know what's available and how we can be partners.
Thanks, Rick. Linda.
Thank you, of course, and I think some of the areas have already been mentioned by my opponents up here. Farnsworth, right off of 88, especially heading south. Farnsworth, New York Street, where a lot of our citizens on the far east side feel that they can't go past that for some reason. There's a mechanism in their mind that they want to hurry up and jump down on Farnsworth and get onto 88 to go around to the west side. Orchard Road could be a booming business corridor, and we're not giving enough attention to that. We have New York Street going in from further than Farnsworth, just west of that, and downtown entrances itself too. But Mr. Guzman brings up a really good point. I mean, look at the West Plaza and Lake Street as well. Lake Street could use a lot of beautification too. Is that we need to start looking and redeveloping. Hobby Lobby gone, Walmart gone, Cosmopolitan Market gone, and the Litany. We've lost not only their property tax base, but the employees that work there that put money into this city, and not only, especially with Walmart, our seniors have nowhere to go now. So that whole format needs to be redone. We don't need as much parking. We need more businesses that you can walk to, dine at. Your neighbors can go and have a microbrewery or a wine. But of course, we need to concentrate in those corridors. We need to look like we're open for business and we have money here to attract the people to come off of 88. We're getting a lot of dollars at the outlet mall, and I'm glad that's in my district, but we need to bring it across the river too.
Thanks, Linda. Okay, we go back to Mike at the start. Probably have time for a couple more questions. Changing the gear a little bit, how do you feel about having Planned Parenthood in Aurora?
Well, the issue of Planned Parenthood is very emotional and passionate on either side of the issue. They did come into the city in 2007 without really telling us what type of facility that they were. The city council did approve the zoning of it, and we found out about it after the fact. Ultimately, though, the issue of Planned Parenthood is not under the purview and how they operate. The city, with the county, or with the state of Illinois, it's a federal issue. So as long as they meet the federal needs, then they can operate. As long as they can meet the zoning needs of Aurora, then they're allowed to operate as well. And I know there's people, like I say, passionate on both issues. There is an agreement for people that are allowed to protest what's going on there as long as they don't interfere with the comings and going of people in the shopping center. So ultimately, I would enforce all the rules and regulations as mayor in the city of Aurora.
Yeah, I think we can talk about how Planned Parenthood came to Aurora. There is a lawsuit that was mentioned at yesterday's forum. But the reality is that the job of the mayor is going to be able to figure out how do we find common ground? How do we work with things that are within our control? And as has been mentioned, this is a matter of federal constitutional law. But it doesn't mean that we can't still find common ground. And one of the things I've talked about, we've gotten this question at many of the forums, is my work over the years, over 10 plus years with Family Focus, which has an early childhood program that includes identifying teenage mothers or teenage pregnancies when they occur in the high schools and helping to go and make sure that those young teens know that there is a support structure out there. If they can't find it within the home, there's a support structure that is being created within the community. And in many instances, this early childhood program has been able to be funded through the city of Aurora. And what happens when you help people know that there are people there who care about them, there are people who are going to be with them, is that we have the opportunity to help support the people within our community. And in this case, I think we have saved a number of abortions from ever taking place. That's an area where we can find common ground, and that's the job of the mayor. Understand what's within your control and what's not, and seek to find opportunities where we can agree and work together.
Thank you. Linda.
Thank you. I echo exactly what my two colleagues over here, my opponents, said, but also the fact that we actually can do something about things. We don't have to sit back and feel helpless. Quite a few years ago, my husband and I started Fox Valley Maternity Homes for young ladies who were 12 to 17 that wanted to have their children. And we worked with a lot of the community, the church community, to get this done outside of government. Sometimes I think, and I'm Catholic, sometimes I think we kind of give a postcard to somebody and think it's going to magically get done. We have it within ourselves, and we're empowered within ourselves to make a difference in our community. And that's one area that my husband and I were able to do and help women, young girls, because the Hesed house wouldn't take them because they were too young, and they would either couch surf, find themselves under a bridge, or have an abortion, but help them make a decision and have the child and then give the child up for adoption. There's no easy ways to come to talking about Planned Parenthood without being passionate on one side or the other. As a woman, what I'd like to see our community do is come together and talk about it. Because when I'm understanding statistics over there, there is about 6% of things that we don't agree about, but they do. The other is for low-income women, so they have a choice to plan their family. They do HIV testing. They do cultures on a lot of issues that they can't afford, the community can't afford, but the women are able to access and families are able to access.
Thank you, Linda. Richard?
You know, I think they... issue with Planned Parenthood is how they came into the city using deception under the cloak of night. And what they did was they took our community's ability to have a voice away from us. Now, it doesn't matter whether you're pro-life, pro-choice, that's not the issue. The issue is they took our community's voice away from us. And I know that because the city council meeting immediately after, we found out that it was actually Planned Parenthood setting shop over there in this place that we just thought was a medical facility. We had hundreds of people show up at City Council to speak 3 minutes and to give their voice. We were there till close to 1:30 in the morning, the first city council meeting. And the very next city council meeting, we were there till almost 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, you know, because people wanted to speak out or speak on behalf. Some folks came there to speak for, but the point is, Planned Parenthood, because they did not give us notice as to who they were when they were coming to our city, took our community's voice away from them. And I don't think our community's voice should ever be taken away. I think you should always have a voice in what happens in your city.
Thank you. Okay, hopefully this is a pretty easy question. We're gonna start with Rick. Get a chance to put your spot right up front here. What is your favorite place in Aurora to take a visiting friend or relative and tell us why?
Well, it's the Paramount Theater. It's a beautiful place, obviously. It's historic architecture. One of the things that makes Aurora unique is that Aurora is so comparably rich in the very things that no amount of money can buy: historic architecture, natural beauty, diversity, culture, arts, all these things that compared to a lot of our surrounding cities, we've got a big leg up. The Paramount Theater, though, is I feel like just has something for everybody. I've got a father-in-law who's not a theater guy at all, we brought my mother-in-law to go see Mamma Mia, and he would not be caught dead anywhere near anything having to do with ABBA. But we had and this was interesting, because the thing that we got him to go to, well, first of all, we took him through, and he was blown away without a show there. And the thing that we're going to get him to go to here, it's coming up in a little bit, is it's a kid's show. He said, okay, well, I'll go with my grandchildren to go there. But he's like, and I don't know if I'm going to like it, but I am going to like just admiring that beautiful architecture. My father-in-law is a construction superintendent, and he just marvels at that. And it's something that we should all be proud of. There are a long list of things that we can say about this, but for me, it's easy: the Paramount Theater.
Linda.
Not so easy for me. I love the Outlet Mall. And it brings money back to the taxes, so it's good. I'd have to say Bela Doyle's, because I just, the feel of it, it's just so so urban, but yet so retro, and they're really good owners. They opened up a second restaurant in Naperville, but I'm so happy that they chose us, and they've got a great family, so Bela Doyle's.
Thank you. Richard?
Well, I can lose pizza. Need I say more?
That's a hard question, because I think there's a lot of places that we can bring our friends and family to our city. And there's a lot for us to be proud of. In fact, I've been telling people that we are a happening city, and we are. There's a lot of positive things going on. But if I had to name one, I would say the Paramount as well, for the reasons that Rick stated. And I can tell you, and I'm going to date myself here, but back in the day, when I was a kid, we went to movies there that were 50 cents per person. So we've changed a lot since those good times. But because I would bring them not only to the Paramount, as the reason stated, but I can bring them to other places after the Paramount or before the show starts. I can take them to the many restaurants that we have in downtown Aurora. I can take them to the SciTech, to the GAR, to the Art and History Center, to the Fire Museum. There's a lot of places that we can go to in the downtown Aurora. It's just not one place anymore. So that's where I would take them.
Thanks, Mike. Before I get to the closing piece here, I want to remind everyone that first of all, the primary election is February 28th, and the general election is April 4th. You don't get a mayor unless you go out and vote. So you need to get out and vote to get done. You can go on auroravotes.org for information on the elections. And on a personal note, I have to say that we've come through some tough elections in this last 18 months, getting to the president, the senators, and everyone down the line. And you just get sick and tired of listening to them just bash each other. So I have to say, it was an absolute pleasure sitting here today with these four candidates that did nothing but talk about how to make Aurora better.
you, please feel free to do this as you wish, but with the real Aurora Mayor, please stand up. Next Aurora Mayor, next Aurora Mayor. Thank you all for coming. Next door, man. My pleasure. My mistake. Again, these guys are going to be around until 4. We're going to be here until 4. Please feel free to stand or come up and ask them questions as they're mingling around. Thank you all for being here. This was a great... Do they get a closing statement? We didn't offer them one, did we? Can't give them one. Okay, we'll give you a closing statement, yes. And I guess I'll have to start on the back book here. Who started?
My memory serving?
You would have to start with the mayor.
Linda.
Okay.
Linda.
I want to thank my opponents for coming out this afternoon. It has been up and down a little bit, but I'm glad we're extremely civil because I began with this, I'm going to end with this. If there's anything you remember about today about me, is that I love Aurora. I love its rich traditions, and I love its community histories. I grew up on the hill when there used to be a train station over at that park by the fire department. And I know our best days are ahead of us. And with the caliber of candidates we have up here, I know our best days are ahead of us. So go out and vote. I'm the first one at the top. No, seriously, vote whoever you want to vote for, but just reassure yourself, we're all great candidates and we want the best for the city. So thank you for this great opportunity from both organizations and the facilitators.
You know, there are going to be two Richards on the ballot. Make sure you get the right Richard. Richard Urban. Yeah, you know, running for mayor is no easy task. You know, I know I've been here a time or two, but you know, I want to thank all of our candidates and all my opponents for engaging in this process. You know, I think it's important that all of you know the hearts of who the next mayor of Aurora is going to be. And I hope in all the debates and talking to you know my heart. And I'll keep saying this, it's about leadership here in Aurora. I want to be the leader with the vision that takes us to the future. I was a leader when I was in combat during the Gulf War. I was a leader when I was community-based prosecutor, working with police right here in your community, reducing crime to the low levels that is today. I was a leader when I started my own law practice, 2 blocks down the street from where I grew up in low-income housing, right in our downtown. I've been a leader for the last 10 years as alderman at large for the city of Aurora. There's only 2 of us, and one of them sitting over there, mayor. I shouldn't have stood up, Bob. I should have let you stand up. You didn't move quick enough. But I want to take our city to the future. I have the background, the ability, the credentials to do that, and the experience on city council to make sure that happens. So when you go out and vote on February 28th, I want you to think about who you believe the best leader for the vision of Aurora is, and I hope that person is me. I'm not running for mayor just for me. I'm running for mayor for all of us. Thank you.
Thanks, Richard.
Yes, thank you to Northeast Neighbors and Pigeon Hill Neighbors for sponsoring our 6th mayoral forum. It's been a pleasure to be here with you today. I have, as I mentioned earlier, decades of dedication working for our community. Going back to 1980, I represent a very diverse ward, 50% Hispanic, 12% African American, small percentage Asian, and the rest Caucasian. People know that when they have a problem or a question, they know that they can call me and get a fair answer. And I will do all I can to solve them. I'm the candidate with experience, leadership, vision, and ideas. I've been involved with more policies and programs and implementations than anybody on the council, than anybody here this evening. Over the years, I can say fairly that I'm not only second to none, but I'm first amongst equals. I listen to people and find common ground. It's important because I like to say that we're not going to agree 100% on every issue, but I can be assured of that we're going to agree on most issues. In fact, we're going to probably agree on over 90%, if not 99%, issues that are facing our city. So I like to say that we can sometimes agree to disagree in an agreeable manner. But it's important that when we find common ground, that we do it globally. We look at it as a whole, and that's what I do best. So again, if you go to my catchy website name, MikeSevillaForMayor.com, look at everything that I've done over the years. I'm running a very transparent and open campaign because ultimately, as you know, past is prologue. Look at my past. That will determine my future as your mayor if you elect me. Look at all of ours past. That's why I've got it on the website, because even though we've been here for an hour and a half, it's still not enough time to tell you everything that I've done and everything that I'm going to do if you elect me as your mayor. It's been a pleasure to be here today. Excuse me. I enjoy serving as alderman, and I would enjoy serving as your mayor as well. So, thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike.
Great. Aurora is a community that is on the move. We've got some amazing things going for us. And the biggest asset, of course, that we have is our people. And our people come from all different walks of life. I mentioned the other day that not everybody has the same experience in Aurora, however. And so what we need to do is we need to work together to understand how it is that we all lift each other up. I think that it has been encouraging to stand up here and actually echo a lot of our the same ideas, different ways of going about it. And I'm the youngest one who's up here today. But I do like to point out that though I have only been in government for a little under 20 years, it's all been in the area of helping to run government. So my whole career has been trying to work on how to improve our communities, how to do the day-to-day operations that the mayor will have to do to help to balance budgets, to put those together, to implement the programs and policies that come from those, to oversee large staffs. And so while I am the youngest, I do have the most experience in what the job duties of mayor actually are. But you do have some good choices here. And I encourage all of you to look at all of the candidates, as others have said, and I think recognize what we are blessed with here at Aurora, which is a very different thing than what you find at the national level. A very different thing that you will find in any of our neighboring communities. Aurora is unique in some profound and wonderful ways, and we are truly blessed to be part of this. And I can't thank all of you enough for coming out and getting involved in the next great chapter of our city.
Thanks, Rick. Again, thank you all. Hang around and ask some questions if you'd like. Thank you again for all of you. Good luck.